We conclude the lecture regarding the power diode that has been mostly concentrated and oriented to the PIN diode with a few words regarding the Schottky diode. The Schottky diode behaves like a diode, we know. It has smaller activation, let's say, on-state voltage drop usually, for very low currents. This is what we know from the basic courses of electronics, of analog and digital electronics. It can be thought as an alternative to a PIN diode when very fast switching is required. From the manufacturer point of view, the Schottky diode uses a metal to semiconductor junction, a Schottky barrier, instead of the PN junction to block the current in the reverse conduction. The Schottky barrier, with respect to the PN junction, usually provides very small forward threshold voltage and also fast switching time. We can see that the conventional PIN diode has a threshold voltage of about 0.7 volts, while for a Schottky diode, depending on the height of the barrier, we have 0.3-0.45. The electrical symbol of the device is this one. We have this line here that becomes an S. And another important aspect that differentiates the Schottky with respect to the PIN diode is the recovery time. Recovery time for Schottky diodes is very fast because Schottky diodes are unipolar devices. They do not have electrons and holes that flow through the device. You only have, if you have an N-doped epilayer, you only have electrons flowing into the device. This means that we do not have minority carriers that are stored during the conduction, and this means that we can switch off the device very fast with very small peak reverse current. There are, however, drawbacks. The most important drawback of the Schottky diode is the very low reverse voltage, volt breakdown voltage that we can get. It's not a physical limitation, but it's a practical limitation. We usually have 100-200 volts for this device, no more than that. And this means, for example, that we cannot use Schottky diodes for connecting the main. This is the schematic of the Schottky diode. It's very simple. You just have the passivation, the guard rings. This is the metal. This is the Schottky barrier metal. And we have the epi layer and the substrate. The properties of the Schottky diodes are primarily determined by the metal energy of the barrier 8 of the metal to semiconductor junction. If we have a metal with low energy barrier height, this will minimize the forward voltage. But this also increases, since you have a small barrier, there is increased leakage current from the device. And this current also increases with the temperature of the device. This means that if I have a very low barrier, the leakage current will be large. On the other hand, if you increase the height of the barrier, this will reduce the leakage current, but also tends to minimize the improvements that we have from the fact that we have a metal semiconductor barrier that should have a threshold voltage that is lower than 0.7 volts. Why do we have a practical limitation on the reverse voltage? The limitation is that it comes from the fact that we do not have conductivity modulation. There are no minority carriers stored into the device in order to that are able to reduce the resistance. This means that the on-state resistance, the R-on value of the resistance, is increased. For a PIN diode with a given thickness, a given area, we have here in the current concentration region our value that we named N-SHU, that is 10 to 17, something like that. That is the carrier concentration value for the reduction of the mobility. For a Schottky diode, we only have this relation, and here we have the doping. The doping is 10 to 14, more or less, 10 to 15. This means that this resistance will be more or less 100 times larger than the PIN diode. This means that for the same breakdown voltage, the on-state resistance tends to be much larger for the Schottky diodes. And this means that we cannot design Schottky diodes for very high reverse voltages, otherwise the on-state resistance becomes huge and you lose all the benefits of using the Schottky diodes that should have a on-state voltage drop that is no larger than 1-2 volts. This can be seen in a very clear way if we recall that the breakdown voltage and the doping in a PN junction, but this is also true for the Schottky diodes. We also in that case we have a barrier with a drift region where the electric field increases in reverse blocking mode. We know that the doping is more or less inversely proportional to the breakdown voltage. Now, if we substitute this doping value in the on-state resistance for the Schottky diode, the expression that we get for the on-state resistance is this one. We get more or less a constant multiplied by the square of the breakdown voltage. This is exactly what we said before. For very low voltages, the advantage of having a small activation voltage and maybe still a small on-state resistance is possible to exploit this advantage. If the reverse blocking voltage, the breakdown voltage, increases, in this case we have an on-state resistance that increases with the square of the breakdown voltage, while for the PIN diode, if we recall the equation that has been shown before, the on-state resistance will increase more or less linearly with the breakdown voltage. This is why the Schottky diode is usually limited to low voltage application, where fast switching is a major requirement. It must be said that in recent times, the interest in Schottky diodes in power application is growing. This is due to the availability of new semiconductor materials, we will study them in a future lecture, like silicon carbide, that are able to sustain much higher voltage for the same on-state resistance. And this means that the application range for the Schottky diode, if you move to silicon carbide or other materials that have very wide band gap and they are named wide band gap materials, is extended.